sleeping on the come up with a 211 in my mind, persuaded by the devil gripping on my blood, passing now, searching for a lick that I can hit with murder in my soul, swinging bending corners in the 67 Elko.
One Piece is a long-running shonen series that is home to a long list of colorful and memorable characters. And perhaps what builds the bulk of their more distinct and interesting characters is their villains, dastardly members of the seas who play as much of a role defining the series as the Straw Hats, with many of them still persisting the fan polls today. Buggy the Clown has been chasing glory since the series' inception. Don Quixote Doflamingo still haunts people's nightmares and the zeitgeist today. Even Wapple, the cartoonish king from the Drum Island arc, has newfound prominence and importance within the series' latest arcs. However, not every villain remains with the fans as consistently. For a series that has spanned more than 20 years, a few villains have slipped through the cracks and people's memories, probably never to see the light of day again. In memory of the forgotten, this list will be running down the top most forgettable villains from One Piece. Silver Fox, Foxy. To give credit where credit is due, Foxy had plenty of screen time in the anime, perhaps too much. Being given an extended version of his arc plus an extra filler arc, the captain of the Silver Fox Pirates is probably one of the most prominently shown villains in the series, which speaks levels to how unnoteworthy he ended up being. While having a pretty festive crew and gimmick in the Davy Back fight, the Silver Fox Pirates themselves aren't exactly all that memorable either, mostly due to their lack of impact or danger to the overlying story. Within the community, his Long Ring Island arc is kind of perceived as not only the least consequential of the One Piece story arcs but also the most skippable, which some fans tend to do with no actual repercussions. Jin the Man, Demon. For those who don't remember, Jin was one of the commanders of the Krieg Pirates during the Baratie arc, who entered the Baratie near Starve. He's the one who inspired one of Sanji's most defining speeches in the series and essentially convinced Luffy to take Sanji up as the Straw Hat Chef. Jin wielded custom, dual tonfas and ended up betraying Sanji later on. What puts Jin on this list is not only how forgotten he's become in the story but just how frustrating he is as a forgotten thread. Jin ended the arc being poisoned by Don Krieg's own gas attack. As he carried his captain away, readers and viewers everywhere were left to think whether or not he would die at sea, leaving a cliffhanger that would never be resolved. Iron Mace, Alvida. Here's a shout out to who was essentially Luffy's first pirate foe in his big quest to find the One Piece. Former captain of the now-defunct Alvida Pirates, the Iron Mace was originally portrayed as this nagging, fat woman who raided ships and, at one point, kidnapped a young Kobe, instigating his entire story arc. She pretty gave the major introduction to how Devil Fruits worked, as she was Team Rocket Ashley blasted away by Luffy. Having later eaten the smooth fruit and getting a character redesign for reasons, Alvida is now part of Buggy's ranks, never to really utter a substantial line ever again. Double Iron Fist, Full Body. Double Iron Fist, Full Body gets some credit for arresting Jin and bringing him to the Baratie for his entry on this list, as well as his cover arc with Django. However, unlike the Michael Jackson-esque, hypnosis-wielding Django, there is not much to really remember about Full Body, design or personality-wise. He uses iron knuckles and made a sly comment about the Baratie's wine, get it? Full Body. Other than that, he's just become part of an eccentric duo that works under Black Cage, Hina, which speaks more about Hina than Full Body himself. Kurubi. Much to the surprise of One Piece fans, a lot of long-running references and consequences have arisen from the Arlong Park arc. Fans would later find out that Arlong Park was inspired by Sabaody Park. Arlong would play a pivotal role in the backstory of the Fishman Island arc. Even the silly octopus Hachi would get his own cover story and play major roles in helping the Straw Hats later on. However, not every fishman would be as equally rewarded from that arc. Making this list was Sanji's own opponent in the Arlong Clash, Kurubi. At the very least, his shipmate Chewy got a funny fight against Usopp. Designed after a stingray and user. Of martial arts, Kurubi himself really came off more as a generic villain used to just hype up Sanji in a generic fight. Fukura. On the note of less memorable, secondary villains, there are arguably a few from the Enies Lobby arc. However, if any of them have less of a right to be forgettable, it would be the main antagonists in CP9, with each of them getting at least something. Khalifa had a funny exchange with Nami. Kumadori had the honor of introducing Chopper's monster point. Even Rob Lucci's pigeon came out pretty memorable. However, it's the green, zipper-mouthed monster in Fukurov that would leave the island the least substantial. Bearing an incredibly distinct design and a contrasting character quirk in being talkative as a secret agent, one would think Eiichiro Oda was overcompensating for a lack of character development. All of Enel's priests. This may seem like cheating, but there's not really much to say about one of the priests that didn't apply to the other in terms of being noteworthy or not. Enel's priests didn't really represent much besides defending Enel, as each one was more defined in design and gimmick than any actual philosophy, which is unfortunate given the slight religious undertones of the Skypiea arc. However, in the defense of the ordeal of Swamp Gedatsu, he was the only priest to not only leave the arc essentially unscathed, but with his own cover story. Not a memorable cover story, but a cover story nonetheless. Big Knife, Sarquis. Bellamy the Hyena has quickly risen up in One Piece acclaim given his massive character arc during the Dressrosa arc. The same can't be said, unfortunately, for the rest of his crew, let alone his first mate, Big Knife, Sarquis. The Bellamy pirates as a whole seem to represent a big paradigm shift within the One Piece world, given their tutelage under Doflamingo. Sarquis himself had a whopping 38 million berry bounty, a large, gimmick knife, and would even, unfortunately, be used by Doflamingo to punish and slash down Bellamy later in the Logatown arc. Despite that interesting background and such a tragic role, Sarquis himself would seem to be just another casualty in Bellamy's backstory, as he didn't seem to survive his crew's expedition to Skypiea. Mr. Nine. Baroque Works was host to a variety of interesting villains, such as Daz Bones or Mr. Two. As interesting a cast of characters that this arc had, there are a few less remembered agents from the bounty hunting corps. For this list, the big shout out will be going to the most eccentric thread in Princess Vivi's backstory, Mr. Nine. Acting as her partner under Baroque Works, Mr. Nine was a loyal friend and eccentric combatant who wore king-like attire and sported two baseball bats. To his credit, Mr. Nine didn't end his arc as a villain, as he assisted Vivi's escape with the Straw Hats and would even receive a small cover story nod to his newfound family with Miss Monday. Nozomi. Possibly having the least screen time out of anyone on this list, Marine Captain Nozomi played a pivotal role during the Arlong Park arc, neglecting any marine attention towards Kokoyashi Village in exchange for bribes. Playing to his name, he has a very mousy demeanor and comes off as incredibly greedy and conniving. As a whole, there's not really much else to say about a guy who received very limited lines, showed no combat potential, and even played the cartoonish villain chasing the Straw Hats at the end of the arc. However, this list even remembers him at all, as he was responsible for one of the greatest trademarks of the Straw Hats, giving Luffy his iconic first bounty poster. As small of a role as it was at least fondly remembered, if not consistently.